We're going to get started. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. All right, there we go. My name is Ben Dworkin. I am the director of the Rebovich Institute for New Jersey Politics. On behalf of Rider University and the Rebovich Institute, now celebrating our 15th anniversary, welcome to an evening with Tom Byrne. You're here. This is our second public event this semester and is part of our ongoing Governing New Jersey series, a series that has brought together every major potential candidate for governor in New Jersey. All of them have come to Rider. We're thrilled that we were able to get Tom Byrne tonight. Allow me to just recognize a couple dignitaries that we do have here. President Gregory Dell'Omo. He's here. There he is. Okay, university president. Thank you so much for coming. As we begin, I'd like everybody to actually take out their cell phone. Take it out. Now's the chance to take a selfie. Tell everybody that you're here with all the cool people, okay? And please post it. We want people to know on social media. This is for my students as well. Take it out. Take a selfie. Tell them where you are. And then turn your phones off, okay? So nothing rings. Please use hashtag Rebovich Inst in order to just let people know where you are. Now's the chance to make people jealous. The first part of our dual mission at the Rebovich Institute is to raise the level of political discourse. With programs like tonight, we try to make everyone a little bit smarter. And when everybody is better informed about the issues of government and politics and business and the economy and any number of different issues that face our state, when everyone is better informed, we believe that there can be a more enlightened discussion about how to face these challenges in our great state. Now, the second part of our mission is to train the next generation of political leaders, something that our speaker tonight, I can speak to from personal experience, has been committed to throughout his career in public life. So our work here at the Rebovich Institute involves and relies on helping our students not just get internships, but helping them be supported in those in these internships by giving them scholarships. Fact is, we all know that internships are a crucial piece of anybody who's building their career. And unfortunately, in politics and public policy and government, they're virtually all unpaid. It makes it really tough on a lot of students to be able to do it. We do something about that. We raise money, we give it away. This past summer, we gave away $17,000 in scholarship money. We're hoping to increase that. And one of the ways that everybody here, the way you can be supportive, inside your program tonight, you'll see that on March 10th, we're having our biannual Rebovich Gala. We really hope that you will be able to be a part of it and to be supportive of this cause. Let me just tell you how tonight's program will work. I forgot one dignitary I do want to recognize, somebody here, our namesake, Missy Rebovich is here in the audience. I just want to recognize her. Thank you so much for coming out. Sorry about that, Missy. So here's how tonight's program is going to work. I'm about to introduce a Rider student who will introduce Mr. Byrne. And at the conclusion of Tom's remarks, we're going to open it up for questions, as is our tradition. The first two questions need to come from Rider students. You know who you are. Come up with good ones. Please note that we're recording this. Everything should be considered on the record. During the question and answer session, we will have two student volunteers holding wireless microphones like I'm holding now. If Mr. Byrne calls on you to ask a question, wait a moment. It's not that big a room, but just wait a moment for the student to get to you with the microphone. This is so that we can hear it on the video recording. People who can't get to it this program tonight are going to want to be able to see it online, and will only be able to hear the question if you have the mic with you. So just wait for the student to get to you. I always enjoy showing off our Rider students, and so it's a privilege now to bring up a young woman from North Cape May, not Cape May, North Cape May, I was told, a junior who is double majoring in both political science and French. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome one of this year's Rebovich Fellows, Samantha Bender.
Can everyone hear me? Ruth? Awesome. Good evening. Tonight, I have the honor of introducing a very special speaker, Tom Byrne. He graduated from Princeton University in 1976 and then proceeded to get his JD from Fordham Law School. He practiced law with a major firm in New York City and was an institutional security trader at Lehman Brothers. Following the stock market crash in 1987, he became a member of the Brady Commission that reported regularly to President Reagan of the causes of the crash. From 1994 to 1997, he served as the chairman of the Democratic Party in New Jersey. Recently, he served on a bipartisan gubernatorial commission charged with coming up with a plan to fix New Jersey's underfunded state pension system. Currently, Mr. Byrne runs an investment advisory business with offices in both Princeton and New York. He is also chairman of the New Jersey State Investment Council, which oversees $70 billion in public pension money. Mr. Byrne is an inspiration to any student aspiring to become successful in the realm of politics and finance. He is truly inspiring to me because this semester I started interning at the Senate Majority Office in Trenton. I now have an ever-growing passion for helping the state through politics and which Mr. Byrne has done throughout the year. Please join me in welcoming to Ryder and the Rebovich Institute, Tom Byrne.
Thank you, Samantha. That was very nice. Appreciate it. Thank you so much. Well, it's nice to be at Ryder, and I guess I should say back at Ryder, because one of the critical parts of my biography goes back more years than I care to admit, but when I was at West Orange High School, I was selected to come to New Jersey Boy State, which is hosted here, and I've come back a number of times to speak at Boy State, and I've always enjoyed that. Again, a lot of young people who are interested in politics have a civic commitment, and you know, I commend all of you, particularly young people who have that fire burning in you and don't let it dim. So I came to Boy State, and it's a week of seminars on government and how it works, speakers from state government and private industry and so forth. And then there are mock elections. So you start with elections for mayor and then state legislature, and then they elect a Boy State governor. And after about 3 days, I thought to myself, I didn't come here with any preconceived notions. After about 3 days, I came here and I thought to myself, I know more about these state issues than anybody I've met here, so why not run for Boy State governor? So I did, and I won. And it was an interesting time, and Gil Lugosi, I remember that the freeholders were good hosts and had me to a number of events. I traveled all over the state, met a lot of people. It's an American Legion sponsored program. The American Legion wasn't too happy with me for a while because I came out at age 16 in favor of decriminalization of marijuana, and they didn't like that too much, but I think they decided I was an okay guy anyway. I'm going through a little bit of the same thing now. I'm looking around, I'm thinking to myself, I really think I know more about the key issues facing this state and have the background in dealing with some of them than anybody else I see out there, so why not run for governor? So I'm thinking very seriously about it. I haven't made a decision. I don't want to make a decision until after this year's election is concluded. But what are the differences? Well, the differences are, when I ran for Boy State governor, nobody had $30 million in their pocket that they were willing to spend to win. The county organizations didn't play a role, and county organizations in real politics matter. And they have largely endorsed Phil Murphy, who I think is a very nice guy, by the way. And the third thing is a lot of the labor union endorsements have already gone to Phil. And those things make a very, very big difference, not necessarily an absolutely decisive difference, but make a big difference in politics. So I'm going to start with a quick civics lesson on how politics works and in some good, maybe not so good way. So I thought that this would be a fairly crowded field. It's not usual that it's an open seat for governor, and you would expect a large crowd of people to seek it. And that's the way the Democratic primary was shaping up. And I thought I could run as a fiscal moderate, and I'll get into why I think that's important, and hopefully get through a Democratic primary where, you know, the general rule is in a Democratic primary, you run to the left if you want to win, and in a Republican primary, you run to the right, like Ted Cruz or whatever. And so I thought in a crowded field, there could be a path sort of down the middle, and I think that's what New Jersey needs, and I'll go through why. So, 2 weeks ago or thereabouts, out of the blue, Stephen Fulop, the mayor of Jersey City, who some saw as the front runner because he has a base in what is either the largest or second largest city in New Jersey, and has an alliance with Roz Baraka, the mayor of the other largest city in New Jersey, seemed to have a strong political base, was traveling everywhere, was out every night for the last 2 or 3 years, and everybody assumed he was running. All of a sudden, without much explanation, decides he's not running for governor and endorses Phil Murphy. And my take on it is that it had less to do with an alliance between those two and more to do with a rivalry between North Jersey and South Jersey, which in this case has gotten very, very personal. And so Fulop and George Norcross, who is sort of the behind-the-scenes political power in South Jersey, really despise each other. There's no nicer way to put it. And so it was a little bit the enemy of my enemy is my friend. He endorses Murphy. That set off a wave of momentum that made a lot of the northern county chairs, who were warm toward Phil, endorse him. And then, all of a sudden, what I'm told, and I was not in the room, I'm told that a lot of the northern leaders kind of sat down and started figuring out who was going to do what, who was going to have what jobs, and they were going to put the Speaker of the State Assembly in the cabinet, and they were going to give the Assembly speakership to one county, the Lieutenant Governorship to another county, the Senate presidency to another county, all in North Jersey, at which point the South Jersey guys are, whoa, we better play some defense here. And so Steve Sweeney, I think, made a decision to hold on to the Senate presidency so South Jersey still had a voice in state government. So he endorsed Murphy as well. So Phil has a lot of momentum at this stage. What I know from watching politics is that momentum can change very, very suddenly. Different things can happen very, very quickly, and so there's no reason for me to make a decision yet. I grew up with this. My dad was governor of the state for 2 terms in the 1970s. Nobody thought it would be 2 terms because his favorability rating at one point, nobody remembers this, and that's a good thing, so I should not remind you, but I will. My dad put in the state income tax, and his favorability rating at one point was as low as 16%. I remember being at a meeting that was held in New York City, so nobody would find out about it, where key advisors sat him down and said, listen, with your popularity where it is, you have no chance of winning, and you can't drag down the Democratic Party. You did the right thing. The state needed a more progressive tax system to fund schools fairly. You did the right thing. History will remember you kindly, but there is no chance you could win. Now, this is a separate talk, and it's an interesting political case study. Bill Clinton and my wife were together at a public event, and he spent 10 minutes recounting in detail that campaign, because he was a young governor at a time, and it was really sort of imprinted on him, having lost one election early on in his career himself. Anyway, so my only point there is that things can change quickly, and who knows, so I will bide my time and make an appropriate decision. So, on Friday, I was up at the New Jersey Performing Arts Center, and I shared a podium with Phil Murphy, and with John Wisniewski, an assemblyman from Middlesex County, and with Jack Cittarelli, who's a Republican assemblyman who's an announced candidate. And they asked us to comment on an urban agenda for the state. And they had done a poll that they passed out with the program, and it said that what urban residents cared most about was safety, education, and jobs in the urban areas. And I said, look, in the last many years, we've made great progress in our cities. A lot of good things have happened. But it's also true that this poll basically mirrors a poll that I took in 1995 when I was Democratic state chairman. People are worried about the very same things today that they were then. And so we went through, what are we going to do on each of these issues? So I talked first about safety. I talked first of all about police presence and there being more cops on the street in urban areas and the importance of community policing and things like that. I also talked about what I see as a misallocation of resources. I believe, and I've written this in op-eds over the years, that we have too many cops in some of our very safe suburban towns, including my hometown of Princeton, where there's, I think, too many speed traps, and I'm not complaining. I haven't gotten caught in any, and I don't think ever, but still. In Trenton, I don't think there are enough police. And when you look at the pay, the pay generally is higher in the suburban areas than it is in the cities. And in the cities, it's a much more dangerous job. And so these are just resource decisions that I think have to be changed, and the state can do a lot there. I had a great conversation with the mayor of Trenton a couple weeks ago, and we were talking about you can really isolate and target who some of the bad actors are in cities. You know, a very small proportion of people do a lot of the damage. And on the flip side of that, we're jailing too many really minor drug offenders. And I'm not going to go into that. I presume that if you're here, you've read a lot of those articles about our incarceration rates and all that sort of thing. That stuff is changing, and it has to change. There are cities in New Jersey, East Orange in particular, that has adopted expensive but great new technology that can almost has predictive power to see where crimes might be occurring and getting a response quickly and so forth. So we can go back. We can go into the cities more during the question period. I'm happy to do it, but I'm still on page one, and I don't want to talk forever tonight. I want to leave time for questions. So I'm going to move to education, another big issue in the urban areas, and one that I feel very, very strongly about. And if you look at my wife and our charitable giving, a lot of it's directed at education, including, by the way, financing internships at the summer internships at where I went to school at Princeton and where she went to school at Mount Holyoke, because I favor higher minimum wage. I think almost every Democrat does. I think most people do. And I think it's frankly outrageous that the government mandates it for everybody else, and then they have unpaid internships themselves. And so we finance some of that. And we get great letters from young people every September about great experiences they had here and abroad and so on. Anyway, so we care a lot about education. So I guess it was a week ago, I did the screening before the NJEA. And you know, they asked questions about tenure and seniority and all this sort of thing, and charter schools. And I told them that I would change the tenure laws, not in radical ways, but I said to them, we had so-called tenure reform in New Jersey, and we increased the review period from 3 years to 4 years, and we called it reform. I said, I don't think it made any difference at all, frankly. And they said, we pretty much agree with that. And I remember talking to a friend of mine, happens to be another Goldman Sachs guy, who left and got an alternative certification and went and taught math in Trenton for a couple of years. Said it was the hardest thing he ever did. He said 15% of the teachers were fabulous, gifted, terrific. 70% of them were run-of-the-mill, and in his words, 15% had no business being in the classroom. I don't know what the right percentages are, but if people in any profession aren't doing a job, at some point we have to deal with it. Kids' lives are too important. Nick Kristof, the Times columnist, wrote an op-ed maybe 2 years ago and said, Eureka, its studies show that the quality of a teacher is the most important variable in a kid's education. I'm thinking to myself, do you really have to be a Rhodes Scholar to figure that out? I mean, it's just common sense. And we have to deal with it. Kids' lives are at stake, and we have to deal with that sort of thing. And the other big piece of this, I think, is training of principals. And so one of the organizations that we support is a group called New Leaders in Newark that trains people to be principals of urban schools. And again, I think you have to empower principals to do their jobs and to be real CEOs and so forth. And so there's a lot you can do in schools. One of the questions in the NJEA questionnaire was, do you favor a moratorium on charter schools while we study their efficacy? And the correct answer was yes, and my answer was no. And I'm all for studying things, and I certainly don't believe that charter schools are a panacea by any stretch. There are good ones and there are bad ones, but I certainly don't want to shut down or underfund the good ones. And when you look at the evidence, whether in Newark or Camden or elsewhere, the results are absolutely amazing. The KIPP schools closed the achievement gap and surpassed national averages in reading and math by eighth grade. 88% of these kids receive reduced or free meals, which is a measure of poverty, higher than the overall average in Newark. 92% of the kids are African American. 95% of their seniors went to college last year. You talk to Gloria Bonilla Santiago, who founded the first charter school in Camden. Again, similar outstanding results. She told me that they get 55% of the funding that the public schools in Camden get, and they produce far better results. And one little tidbit here. I don't know every detail here, but she told me the district spends $1,200 per kid on custodial services, and her school spends $400. It's not a dirtier school. So the point is, we have to make maximum use of the resources that we have. And so, our cities aren't going to be great until the schools in the cities are great and uniformly great. And we've seen what works, and we have vested interests that I think are threatened by that. And in a Democratic primary, they have a lot of influence, and I think it hurts kids. And obviously, kids don't vote. I think it really distorts our system. I think it hurts our educational system. And I think that has profound consequences for the state of New Jersey, and it's time that we stand up and deal with it. So again, there's infinitely more to say on education. The third thing that came out in this conference on Friday was we talked about jobs. And a lot of politicians get up and say, well, we'll fix the cities if we just bring in more jobs. And they make it sound like you can wave a wand and the jobs will appear. And the jobs, it's not so easy, and so it would be nice, but they don't just materialize. And I've listened to politicians say, "Oh, New Jersey's historically been the innovation economy, and Thomas Edison was here, and that's great, and we should be proud of it." But we've lost a lot of that. In the pharmaceutical industry, we have about half the market share in terms of employment that we had two decades ago in this state. We're losing a lot. A friend of mine just stepped down as the CEO of one of the biggest pharmaceuticals in the state, and he told me that while they have admin stuff and so on in New Jersey, they have no research scientists here. He says, can't attract them they don't want to work in New Jersey. It's for a lot of reasons. Some of it is the tax policy in this state. Some of it relates to the collaboration between higher ed and industry. And it's not just necessarily the contractual relationships that can matter a lot, but it's also just as the CEO of another one of the big companies said to me, scientists want to live in academic communities. Those are the sort of people they want to interact with informally. And so Palo Alto has created that. Cambridge 128 has created that. We have some of it in New Jersey, but not enough. And some that's in the metropolitan area is in Tribeca and so forth. And we need to do more here. And so we need to make bigger investments in higher education, both in terms of college affordability and in terms of building the state's economy. So the top engineering school in New Jersey is Princeton's. Last time I looked, it was ranked 17th in the country. And it's too small to matter, frankly. It's not a big enough engineering school. So you look at the correlation between where the innovation is occurring, where so many jobs for young people are sprouting up. This matters, and you have to make investments. And so that's part of it. Another part of it is our tax code. I'm simplifying just a little bit here, but not by much, and I've had meetings just in the last 2 weeks with tax experts at one of the big accounting firms in the state. So, example, somebody in this room starts a business, I invest in it. The business loses, while it's gearing up, my share of the losses in year one are $250,000, let's say. In year two, we lose another $250,000. Then we hit the J and we start to make money, and in year three, we make $500,000 my share. So I'm now at zero in terms of my economic position, and my tax liability is on $500,000 because the New Jersey tax code doesn't allow carry forwards like the federal tax law does. And a lot of what we need to do is simply conform our tax laws more to the federal law. And these tax experts say New Jersey has the highest compliance costs of any state just because we're so different even than most other states. And so this is technical stuff, but it matters in terms of job creation. If we want to attract investment dollars into this state, and hopefully a lot of that in urban areas, this is the sort of stuff we have to do. So. You all look still awake, so now I'm going to get to the really boring part of this. What I said is that none of this stuff is going to happen unless we deal with the state's pension issue. And New Jersey has, if not the biggest, certainly one of the biggest unfunded liabilities of any pension system in the United States. I was asked to serve on a bipartisan commission to deal with this. When I was asked to do so, I said, happy to, but if I don't like the results, I will feel free to say so, and if you want me on those terms, fine, okay. So I serve on it. This commission had some of the smartest and best actuaries in the United States on it, and I dare say we're not going to get the same kind of intellectual firepower around this issue again anytime soon. So, what does the commission come up with? We did two reports. The first one was, how did we get in this mess? And I'm not going to get deeply into it other than to say we concluded unanimously that the last six governors simply didn't contribute into the pension system anywhere near the amount that they were supposed to contribute. Why? Because every year, no matter what, whether the economy is good or whether the economy is bad, and particularly in years when the economy is bad, revenue in state taxation doesn't grow automatically. Mr. Former Treasurer does it. So there are down years. And in any circumstance, there are pressures no matter what, and the path of least resistance seemed to be for years to just not put the money into the pension system that you were supposed to put in. Kick the can down the road. There's not going to be any immediate consequences, so somebody else can deal with it. So at some point, it gets to be at a stage where people start to go, you know, if we don't deal with this quickly, the money's going to run out. And who knows when that is. The best metaphor I can give you on this one is I remember being homesick when I was maybe 10 years old. I read a Reader's Digest article, and I don't know why this one stuck with me, but it says that if you're in a rowboat in the middle of the Niagara River and you're a quarter mile up, you can row as hard as you want. You're going over. And we don't know where we are, but we know that it's getting that close. I've had very smart, very responsible experts tell me that they think it's already too late to save the public employees and the teachers' pension funds. Now think about that. These are people that have worked hard, have played by the rules, have signed up for a deal where some of their compensation is deferred, and now the state is saying, we may not have this money. I believe we can save it, but I don't think we can save it with pixie dust. I mean, there are difficult decisions that are going to have to be made. And so I'm going to leave out some details, but try to simplify what the commission said. We looked at state employee health care plans, and we said they're far more generous than anything you get in the private sector, far more generous than what Obamacare is talking about. And so if we rationalize these plans and put public employees essentially on Obamacare Gold, the highest level basically, or its equivalent, we can squeeze out $1.4 billion a year in savings. And that's in the context of a $35 billion a year, 34.8, I guess, state operating budget. That's a lot of money. We said recycle that money to help fill the unfunded liability in the pension plan. We also said that right now the public employees are in a defined benefit plan that has an assumed rate of return of 7.9%. Translated, taxpayers are essentially today underwriting a 7.9% annual return in public employee pensions. The private sector has said that kind of stuff is no longer sustainable. We're going to just put people into 401k plans. They manage their own money. We wish them luck and hope it all works out. Academic studies say it may not work out so well, another subject. And we said We don't think that's really fair, but we can make certain changes. We can make a hybrid plan that no longer guarantees a 7.9, but does guarantee some reasonable market rate of return, maybe tied to the 30-year treasury or something like that. And also stop some of the salary abuses. Well, I don't want to say the word abuses, but right now, this final average salary, last 3 years, overtime can count toward that. And so we said it should be a straight line accrual. Anyway, the actuaries say we can save $1 billion a year by making those changes, recycle that money to help fill the unfunded liability as well. I say, if we're going to do that, we need to guarantee public employees that these savings will indeed go into fill the unfunded liability in their pensions and not to some other, not in 2 or 3 years, to some other, you know, pet programs worthy or whatever that legislators may want. And the only way to do that is a constitutional amendment, mandating that. They go, fine, fair enough. So we go out on that. Now, then what happens is some of the Democrats in the legislature, led by Steve Sweeney, say, I want a constitutional amendment too, but I want a constitutional amendment that doesn't depend on any of these conditions or savings, just a straight out mandate that the state fully fund these pension obligations. And that would cost at least another $3 billion a year. And again, in the context of a state budget that's about $35 billion, a lot of that's already mandatory spending, school aid, state operations are really only about $6 or $7 billion. There's very, very little in the budget that is discretionary spending on open space, environmental initiatives, lead removal in water, all those sorts of things, on and on, priorities that would go by the wayside if we did this. And so at the very last minute, Sweeney actually backed away from this, infuriated the NJEA in so doing. Phil Murphy has been on record as saying he favors this, and it's just a difference between us. I would hope over time he follows Sweeney and backs away from it. I think it would be a disaster for the state, and if you look at a state like Illinois that does have this mandate, it's made life incredibly difficult out there. There are social service agencies doing all kinds of good work, you know, such as like lead removal, so many other areas in social services, dealing with people who really need their help, and a lot of these agencies haven't been paid for over a year by the state of Illinois' government. And, you know, I don't want to see that happen here. Phil Murphy also, he chaired a commission about 10 years ago, how do we deal with this? And they did some things that I think were good. They raised the retirement age for most workers from 55 to 60, but they also did things like recommend asset sales. And again, that's a philosophical difference we have. I don't believe in burning the furniture to heat the house, simple as that. So Corzine kind of ran with that idea, at least for a while, and said, let's either sell or leverage the turnpike and use that money to fill the hole in the pension. And I thought, well, first of all, taxpayers shouldn't subsidize a level of benefits that they themselves don't get. And second of all, turnpike correlates more to infrastructure needs. And New Jersey has Paul Volcker, the former Fed chair, and Dick Ravitch, the former lieutenant governor of New York, did a big study that the Fund for New Jersey, which I'm a trustee, helped fund. And it estimated 2 years ago that New Jersey has $130 billion of unmet infrastructure needs. So that's everything from bridges that are rickety, and you know we don't want them falling down on our watch. Hopefully we don't wait till that. Mass transit issues. If one of the train tunnels, and we're finally making progress on that, but if one of the train tunnels into New York closes, it would wreak havoc on the region's economy. Right now, there's two tunnels, inbound, outbound. They have an hourly capacity of 24 trains between the two of them. One tunnel closes. I've said this ought to be an SAT question. What's now the hourly capacity? And people say 12. No, 6, because one tunnel has to handle the inbound and the outbound trains. So you would cut mass transit on the main trunk line in New Jersey capacity by 75%. It's crazy. And that doesn't even get into water quality issues, lead. Somebody told me, I haven't verified this, that in a lot of Trenton at least, the lead levels in kids are higher than they were in Flint. Not from the water, but from the lead in paint and so forth. And Isles, which I used to be a trustee of, and other organizations are doing a good job in trying to deal with that. So anyway, my point is we have to deal responsibly with this pension issue. We have to be fair to state workers, but we also have to be fair to taxpayers, and we have to be fair to people who rely on these state services. And I think what this commission did that as well as anybody could. Our point of departure was that state employees have to get all the benefits that have been promised them to date, but we have to do things going forward. The public employee unions understandably don't want to hear about it. They say no more givebacks, but the rubber has to meet the road somewhere, and we need somebody who is willing to make difficult but fair decisions. And if we don't, as I say, we're not going to be able to fund any of these other priorities that I've talked about. So, and there are so many more. I mean, New Jersey has endless debates about housing policy. And my take in 30 seconds is that we do more to pay lawyers than we do to actually build housing for people who need it. And I was with former Governor McGreevy at an event about a month ago, and he brought probably an early 30-something African-American woman who had been imprisoned for some minor offense. And she comes out and she says, I have nowhere to live. I have a kid. I've been in jail. I have nowhere to live. We have to do something for single mothers in urban areas for housing. And if we're going to spend $3 billion more a year for benefits that, as I say, are higher than you get anywhere in the private sector, we're not going to fund these priorities. And so there are very, very human issues, lives at stake on all this, and so on. Another issue facing New Jersey, and I'm not going to dwell on this because presumably at least half this audience isn't too worried about this subject yet. This state has higher property taxes than any other state in the country, and it's forcing people to move. It's forcing people to leave the state, and it's crazy. And again, some of the reason for this is things that I just alluded to. So this commission, for instance, said that we just talked about reforming health care for state employees. If you implemented the same reforms at the local level for county and local employees, the same health care reforms and just the health care reforms, and there were no other variables, you would save $2.5 billion in health care costs. New Jersey municipalities collect about $28 billion in property taxes. So figure that out. Right there, if there are no other variables, you're cutting property taxes by 8 to 9%. So when politicians say, oh, there's nothing we can do about that, well, yeah, there are things we can do about that. I'm not suggesting they're easy, but there are things we can do about it. Our pay for, or just plain pay scales for certain public employees is very high. I have a friend named June Choi who was mayor of Edison up until, I don't know, 5-6 years ago. Smart guy, was an aerospace engineering major at MIT, and still went into politics, which was a good thing, but he served one term, and he took on the cops in his town and the wage levels there. And June told me, I don't know why these figures stick in my head, they're 6 years old, so they're higher now. He said, a police captain in my town with 20 years of service, base pay is $123,000 and change, but the all-in cost, when you throw in all the benefits, $10,000 of overtime, step allowances, uniform allowances, education allowances, and whatever else, the all-in cost for one guy, $214,000 and change. So you think about it, and this contributes to our property tax burden. Duplication of services, you've heard all that kind of stuff. People don't want to make these tough decisions because you anger groups, and particularly you anger groups, unfortunately, that vote heavily in Democratic primaries. And so that, I think, contributes to some of the mess that we're in. And at some point, someone's going to stand up and deal with it. Now, so how is this different from any candidate who stood here, you know, 4 years ago, 10 years ago, whatever? People talked about budget problems back then, and we've learned to be a little bit complacent, I think, because on June 30th, there's always a headline right at the end of the fiscal year saying, legislature agrees, compromises, and we live happily ever after. So I call us the boy who cried wolf state. You know, we've done that for a while, and it always magically seems to go away, and we assume it always will. But there have been so many gimmicks over the last 20 years, from the pension bonds during the Whitman administration to the tobacco settlement of a couple billion, I forget how many billion, that was supposed to, that was supposed to go exclusively to children's health programs and got used to balance budgets and so forth. And at some point, all this stuff is going to run out, and we're going to really have to deal with things. So one of the first people that actually just emailed me and said, you have to run for governor, is, I'm not sure he wants to be publicly identified, but somebody who's a former chief of staff to a Democratic governor said, you know, you've got to run, otherwise, you know, we're just going to elect another Democrat who will give away the store and raise taxes, and at some point it becomes unsustainable. I think New Jersey has swung from too liberal. I like John Corzine personally, but I remember him standing with Bullhorn at Rutgers and saying, you know, we're going to fight for a fair contract. My successor is Democratic state chairman, who happens to be a labor leader, calls me the next morning, goes, did you see that? He goes, this guy thinks he's Norma Rae. He doesn't understand that he's management. And if you're the governor, you're management. Otherwise, you shouldn't run for the job. And so your job is to stand up for what's fair and making sure that we fund a lot of these services that I've talked about and so on. And so I think we veered from policies that are too far to the left to now policies that are too far to the right. I mean, Christie and wanting to repeal the entire school funding formula and really destroy urban education. I think urban education needs to be reformed, as I said, but to me it's just crazy. So I want to end on a positive note. You know, I've talked to Dick Ravitch, the former lieutenant governor of New York, who I think is a terrific guy. And I said, you know, New York City had a terrible fiscal crisis in the 1970s. How did it get resolved? And Dick said to me, it got resolved by people sitting around a table and agreeing to things that they swore they would never agree to. We're going to get to that stage here, and I think we need somebody who is a leader, who can bring people together, who can do so in a fair-minded way and get to the same place. Look, New York has basically lived happily ever after. It wasn't easy, but New York is a great city now. The economy is booming. Lots of good things are happening there. The same can happen here. I spoke to a group in Princeton the other day, and this has very little to do with anything, but kind of fun. I explained to them that financial difficulties have worked very, very well for Princeton, that Nassau Hall, the administration building on the Princeton campus, was the capital of the United States from July to October of 1783. Why? Because the Continental Congress in Philadelphia had run out of money. The people who fought in the Revolutionary War wanted their pay, their pension, so to speak. The government didn't have any money for their pensions. The Congress was worried about riots and being attacked, and so they skedaddled and came to Princeton, and we've capitalized on that ever since and lived happily ever after. So another example of a financial crisis that in the end came out all right. And so, you know, we can do the same thing here. But, you know, good government really does matter. My wife and I went to Argentina a couple years ago, and while we were there, The Economist magazine, and those of you who are in college who don't read it, it's a fabulous publication. I started reading it when I was a freshman at Princeton, and I've read it ever since. When we were in Argentina, the cover story in The Economist was about Argentina, and it said 100 years ago, people in Europe were deciding where to go for a better life. And a lot of them said, well, we'll go to California. That seems like a nice place with a lot of promise. A lot of other people said, we'll go to Argentina. That seems like a nice place with a lot of promise. Both pretty rational decisions at the time, very different outcomes, and a lot of it had to do with the quality of governance in the two places. And so politics does matter. Good governance does matter. Having young people who care about good public policy and being involved civically absolutely does matter. So as I said at the outset, keep the flame burning bright, and I just want to thank you for your attention tonight. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Good.
All right, so we've got two students who are going to have wireless microphones. Just raise your hand. Mr. Byrne will pick on you to ask a question. Not pick on you, but he will.
I won't pick on you if you don't pick on me. How's that for fair?
But raise your hands. First two questions need to come from Ryder students, so look for young people. Just to pick. And we'll go from there, and just wait for the microphone to get to you. So who's got a question?
Come on, I didn't answer everything, did I? Go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for speaking with us. But
thanks for coming.
I was curious to know your opinion on the park testing that's being implemented in a lot of the public schools now in New Jersey. What's your opinion
on the park testing? this is one of those where I'm somewhere in the middle, which is to say, I don't like too much standardized testing. I don't like teaching for the test. I don't want a loss of creativity in the classroom. I want teachers to be able to act as professionals and do it their way a little bit. And at the same time, you need some kind of minimum standards, and you need some kind of assessment so that you know where you are. A lot of people feel it's been overdone in the park situation. This came up in my conversations with the NJEA last weekend. And interestingly enough, a lot of their objection was the upfront cost that we had to buy new computers. And so the initial costs was something they objected to. We seem to be, that's a one-time thing. To me, it's just a balance. There has to be some test. I have no idea if the park test is the right one or the wrong one. One of the criticisms is that some of the questions are above grade level, and so it intimidates people, and they feel stupid when they can't answer all the questions. And at the same time, if you're a genius, you can, and your teacher knows that, and maybe advances you more. If you're going to have questions like that, you have to make it clear to kids that you're not expected to be able to answer all of them. And so, to me, it's just a balance, and it's another situation where it's a matter of sitting people down and figuring out something that's reasonable that gives you a way to assess and yet doesn't interfere with what the natural flow of a classroom ought to be. One of the objections to the park test, too, at least among some, is that teachers say the unions say they don't want these sorts of tests to be the basis for teacher evaluation. And I agree with that. I think there needs to be there ought to be some evaluations, I think I made clear. I think that there needs to be a small objective component of that, but I think that the best form of evaluation is simply peer review. And when I talk to the union in formal situations, they say, no, we don't like that, and people can have personal agendas and so on. If I talk to retired members of the NJA, they say, you're absolutely right. That's the way it should be done. And so, again, I think standardized tests should be limited. They have a purpose, but they shouldn't dominate what goes on in the school. That gets you there? Go ahead.
I'm a minor in health communication, so I was particularly interested, you mentioned the pharmaceutical companies, so what would be your strategies to keep them in Jersey? Because I know that this was like one of the largest states for those types of jobs.
I know. So the question on the pharmaceutical industry. The first thing is, in anything you do, treat people as customers. And so these companies are effectively customers of the state of New Jersey. So some of it is sitting down and not telling them what you're going to do for them, asking them what they need. And you have to be a little careful there too, because what they need is more tax breaks and more this and that. And the tax breaks in New Jersey can become a little bit of a poker game. You keep a straight face, you threaten to leave, and all that kind of stuff. So there's got to be a balance there. But a lot of it is starting to happen in New Jersey, I think. I alluded to the need for alliances between industry, which in this case would be the medical schools, and the private firms. Now, that sort of research should be going on all over the place here. And I think the alliance between St. Barnabas and Rutgers will help over time, and I think we're building that. I think we've blown it in some ways. Some years ago, Roy Vagelos, the former chairman of Merck, issued a report saying that what higher education in New Jersey needed to do in order to attract more grant dollars. And New Jersey hasn't done a good job of that. Some of that is regional fighting, how much money goes to New Brunswick versus Camden versus Newark, all those sorts of nonsense issues. And a few years ago, again, I talked a lot about the state being financially responsible and too much debt. A few years ago, we voted down a referendum to bring more financing in for biotechnology. And I think people were just, even my father, who's pretty much a liberal, said, how are we going to pay for this? And I think it's one of those investments that you have to make. And so going forward, we have to reduce our overall indebtedness, but there are certain investments that really will pay back over time, I think. And so it's appropriate tax policy. It's treating them as customers. It's continuing to build the alliances that are starting to be made between the private sector and universities. So, And you know, some of it too, one of the problems we've had has nothing to do with any of these issues. The pharmaceutical industry is largely a chemical industry, and the biotech is largely different. It's a biological industry. And so that's just migrated to these other places. And you know, we're not going to completely stop that, but I think we can do more to retain and build that here. And we do have we have an industry group and a pretty strong presence in that field. So I'm fairly optimistic that we can stem the losses and turn it over time. Yes. We're going to have three in a row, and then we'll.
Hi, my name's Lily Miller, and I am a junior here. I'm a political science major. You spoke briefly about providing housing to low-income families. Unfortunately, even though our state government encourages and incentivizes affordable housing, many New Jersey towns still refuse to provide it, or provide housing that is in theory affordable, but by no means accessible to low-income families. As governor, what would you do to combat this issue and provide more affordable housing in towns like Princeton so families don't have to relocate from towns they know and love?
Princeton has actually been one of the more exemplary towns in terms of meeting its obligations long-term. Obviously, not everybody can live there without building skyscrapers or whatever, but Princeton's a pretty built-out place. A lot of other municipalities are not. And so, what we have is a lot of just litigation in the courts. And I don't know necessarily how to stop that. I think some mayors are always going to go to court to stop things that they don't like. But I do think that one of the things that we've lost in this, and this is controversial, is we could do a lot more in the urban areas and around transit centers so people could get to jobs that aren't in the cities and so forth. And we're having a lot of ideological wars about where to build stuff. And you know, when Governor McGreevy brought this woman in who said, I don't care where it is, just give me a roof, I think we've lost a little bit of that. And I just want to see us provide decent housing and also to learn to prioritize. So the last time I read this, which was a while ago, something like a quarter of New Jersey's population is eligible for so-called affordable housing. And we divide the state into regions. And in some of these regions, if you have four kids, your income can be into the six figures, and you're still eligible for affordable housing. Now, at some point, we have to narrow that focus a little bit and prioritize and provide housing for people who need it most before we branch out and go further. Yes, ma'am.
What are your thoughts in making New Jersey a healthier state?
Thoughts in making New Jersey a healthier state. First of all, I'm a huge believer that we have to deal with the lead situation. And I don't even know if we've measured it everywhere that we need to measure it. I mean, here we're talking about we got to fix the schools. Well, if kids have too much lead in their brains, anything else I said doesn't really matter. So we have to make lead removal, whether it's paint or water, a big priority. That's one thing. Another thing that I think we need to do is deal with asthma, particularly childhood asthma. And in areas, particularly around our ports, we have much higher incidences of asthma, particularly in kids, than anywhere else in the state. And I think that there are a lot of more technical initiatives to deal with cleaner ports and to reduce diesel emissions and do all those sorts of things. So that's another thing. Third, in Medicaid, we have expanded coverage to families, and I think that's important. And beyond that, I will tell you that I am not an expert in healthcare. In fact, healthcare is probably the area of state government that I know the least about. And so part of my father's management style, which would also be mine, is you go out and just find the best people and let them do their jobs. And we've had, I think, too many governors in both parties who confuse being governor with being mayor and try to micromanage everything. And I don't think you can do that, or should. And so some of it is just finding the right people to do those jobs. Go ahead.
A major component, I'm a physician and I'm a writer alone.
Okay.
Major component to poor health is the epidemic of obesity.
Yeah.
And one of the major causes of obesity is poor diet.
Yes.
And a sedentary lifestyle.
Yes.
As a governor, what would you do in order to make healthier food more affordable or decreasing a sedentary lifestyle, maybe improving those sidewalks in our neighborhood, making it so that it's easier for our kids to walk to school?
Okay.
Investing in micro-farming, for example.
Yep. Okay, well, you've asked two separate questions. And so as a trustee of the Fund for New Jersey, I've gone on site visits to certain of our grantees, one of whom, I forget the precise name of the organization, but deals with exactly this issue of subsidized meals in schools. And I remember the woman who runs the organization telling me that when we serve healthy food, the kids throw it out. So you tell me what to do. I don't know what to do about that, and not from lack of thinking about it and not for lack of discussing it. Do you tell them that they're going hungry till they eat the carrots, or do you, do you continue to let them eat the junkier stuff? You can't let them go hungry, but I think a lot of it starts with education. This kind of stuff makes you fat. It isn't really good for you. This kind of stuff is actually good for you, and you will get used to it over time. So I think that's part of it, honestly. But I think educating them matters. I'm still working on that. I mean, there are things I eat that and somebody says it's bad for me, and I go, oh, I didn't know that. And the other part of it is the walking issue. I think that certain trends in where the millennials want to live will be long-term helpful. A friend of ours just wrote a book called, I think it's called The End of the Suburbs or something like that. And it's one of the things, she's a writer at Fortune magazine, one of the things that she talked about was exactly this, that we drive in the suburbs, we drive absolutely everywhere, and we need to walk more. So, sidewalks, a lot of places I think have them, and it's maybe an issue of crossing guards or things like that, or enforcing that sort of stuff. But there are also cities. In Atlantic City, if you want to walk from the convention center to the boardwalk, you can't walk on a sidewalk. I mean, to me, that's just extraordinary. So some of it is just, proper planning, better bike lanes, separate bike lanes, a little curb where you can do it. And I'm not saying it's going to be everywhere in the next 4 years. But to have, more bicycle transportation or safer bicycle transportation available and doing that. Some of it too is I live in a neighborhood where there's a 200-yard path through woods and then you have to cross the street and you're at the elementary school. When I was a kid, I didn't live there, but when I was a kid, the kids walked down the path, crossed the street, and went to school. Today they get bussed and they have to go 2 miles where they would walk a half a mile. And it's because everybody's afraid that their kid's gonna get abducted, which doesn't happen in Princeton, and the street's gotten busier. So yeah, you would need a crossing guard there because people come whizzing down and pay no attention to the fact that there's a school there. So more of that kind of stuff I think would matter too. Just encouraging walking where people used to walk and don't anymore. Again, educating people as to the importance of that kind of stuff. I hope that as millennials settle more in urban areas, just as suburban office parks are being vacated and being torn down in places, I'd like to see more intelligent urban living where people do walk more and where there is good mass transit. And I'm hoping that some of that stuff will take care of itself, not completely, but improve things over time. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
What's your stance on expanding the casinos from Atlantic City to northern New Jersey?
First of all, my father is the governor who put the casinos in Atlantic City. And that didn't pass, that was needed a state referendum. It didn't pass the first time. I was a fresh know-it-all 19-year-old kid, and I told my father it wouldn't pass because the first referendum was to allow it throughout the state of New Jersey, and voters didn't want it then. I'm not sure they want it now. Atlantic City has to go beyond casinos and has to become more of a destination resort. And there are a lot of things that can be done there. And maybe that includes tax incentives to have more senior housing there, maybe more creativity. A friend of mine from law school sent me an article about tax incentives for young people to live in buildings where there are a lot of senior citizens, and you spend some time, you know, dealing with them, you know, bringing them meals, talking to them, whatever, in return for cheaper rent. And, you know, creative solutions like that, I think, can make a difference. And so, you know, that's only part of your question. You got to do a lot of things differently in Atlantic City, but I would like Atlantic City, at least in the short term, to keep casinos there. I worry, even though I think we've done a reasonable job of policing organized crime by keeping it confined, I worry about those risks if we expand it around the state, number one. And number two, there's diminishing return at some point to anything. So, you know, I remember years ago when off-track betting was going to be the big thing that saved New York City and New York State. And after a few years, those parlors just became disgusting, frankly, and contributed less and less to New York State's revenue. And I just think there would be diminishing return to anything you do in North Jersey. And so I think even the biggest proponents of it have backed off for now, and I think that's intelligent. Where haven't I gone? Well, you certainly get one, because you gave me a nice introduction. So I'm assuming you're going to stay friendly.
Yes.
Good. I'm only kidding. Ask whatever you want.
Do you believe that the Education Fairness Commission bill that's sponsored by Senate and President Sweeney will help in solving the problem of education being underfunded in various parts of the state?
Well, again, I honestly don't know. I haven't read that bill, so I don't know the details of it. What I can tell you is a couple things. First of all, you want to make sure that the school districts are fairly funded, number one. And there are, shall we say, imperfections or distortions in the school funding formula. And so one of the things that Jack Cittarelli, the Republican who was on this thing on Friday, talked about was that there are millionaires living in really expensive places on the Gold Coast in Jersey City who pay far lower property taxes than people in middle-class towns like Manville. And so we have to fix the formula to make sure that all of the resources aren't going to a very few districts, that kids who live in places like Manville or wherever are getting fair funding. We also have to make sure that, do more to make sure that dollars are being spent wisely. So what I said about custodial services, I mean, I don't know what the right price is, but there's a wide gap between $400 and $1,200. And in Newark, there's supposedly a so-called rubber room where we're spending $30 million to pay teachers who aren't teaching in any school because no principal will have them. You know, stuff like that. You know, $30 million is a lot of money. I mean, in the context of a state operating budget, unfortunately not in the context of our infrastructure needs or our pension deficit, but we have to make sure that the money is spread equitably and used intelligently. And, you know, for so long, there's just been resistance to accountability and making sure that we spend the money wisely in place. I remember when Jim Florio was governor, an assistant commissioner of education showed up at a school in Newark to see what was going on. They wouldn't let her in the door. And I mean, that kind of stuff is crazy. So I don't know if that completely answers your question or drives it what you wanted, but education has to be a huge priority. And at the same time, you know, we spend more money per pupil than any other state, generally speaking, and we're not getting as good a return on investment as we should, number one. And number two, there's a professor at Princeton who I haven't met, but I can remember his name because his name is Professor Dobby. Maybe it's Dobby, but I remember it as Dobby. He's done some really interesting work on, you know, what are the key variables that that affect education outcomes. Obviously, teacher quality is one of them. And he said that we overemphasize class size. Now, maybe K through three, that matters more. But these are things that are coming at us, whether we like it or not. And we're going to have some difficult decisions to make. I wrote an op-ed once. I'm going to get a little bit away from your specific question now. I wrote an op-ed some years ago saying that the solution to, or part of the solution to the property tax question has to be, everybody says, oh, consolidation, that'll fix everything. And when you talk to Ernie Riach at Rutgers, who's a professor and probably the leading expert on this stuff, he says consolidation maybe saved 3 or 4%. It's great, don't get me wrong, but it's not the be-all and end-all. And so I talked about we have to deal with the level of services, which includes duplication of services, and we have to deal with the cost per unit of service. And you know, the example of salaries in Edison is one example of that. One of the things that I did in conjunction with the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation, Chris Daggett, my friend who ran as an independent for governor, the last open seat, together we financed a website called TownStats. And what TownStats was is it put municipal budgets online in simplified form. Municipal budgets are by design impossible to read, are they not? They're impossible. Even state treasurers, Catherine Aristoff, wife of another state treasurer, is here. I bet you Andrew couldn't read them either. You can't. My wife, that's what she does on Wall Street. She's paid to read financial statements, and she's as good as it gets, and can't understand municipal budgets. So anyway, we paid a guy to put these online, and we allowed side-by-side comparisons of one town versus another, and the variances were staggering. Some of it's explainable, but a lot of it just isn't, that some towns will spend 5x in a particular department than other towns. Some of that is a reflection of a different level of demand for services, but some of the variances just don't make any sense, and that's another place where I think the state could just mandate, you know, certain ranges and so on, and whether it's in education or other areas, I think it'd make a difference. By the way, that site is no longer up. The guy who we paid to do it went to work for Senator Sweeney, and the website, I've called him and said, you know, we paid you to leave it up there, and it's not there anymore, and it's too bad. I've copied pieces of it onto Excel spreadsheets, but that's another thing that I would do, is I would make sure that information was up there and transparent so the taxpayers had a clearer sense of where their money was going.
We have time for one more question.
Shucks. Well, you pick it. I'm not going to be the bad guy here.
All right. These are the
easy decisions. All right. Go ahead. The future president.
What will you do about raising the food stamp and SNAP benefits, as currently a single mother can't even work enough jobs to just make above a living without going into time that is physically impossible? And it's called government assistance because it's supposed to assist you getting out of the poverty line. And currently it's either get a job and you don't get government assistance and you still stay poor, or get government assistance and you're still just as poor as you got a job, but nothing's really done and you always stay poor. What will you do about this?
Well, I would love to tell you that you know, I'm going to solve all those problems. There'll be no more poor people in New Jersey if you elect me for governor for 4 years. That's not going to happen. But I spent all of Saturday from 8 a.m. till 2 p.m. at a conference at Princeton University on the issue of income inequality nationally, and academics from, you know, all kinds of institutions. And so it wasn't specifically on food stamps, but I think it addresses your question. We talked about the need to raise a minimum wage, but one of the experts in the country on that issue is Alan Krueger, who's used to be the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors and is now back at Princeton. And Alan has always believed that the minimum wage should be higher. And Alan and I talked about this 5-6 years ago, and he cited a study that in the fast food industry, if you raise the minimum wage, employment actually went up. And my wife and I, when we talk about this, we say that, you know, if you can't pay a fair wage, you know, maybe you shouldn't be in business at all. And at the same time, moving too quickly, and Alan's point was, I said to Alan, what do you think of going quickly to a $15 minimum wage? And he said that he thought that that was too quick a jump and it could cause higher unemployment. and that we needed a variety of tools. One is increasing the earned income tax credit, which I think is important. Another is doing other things in addition to food stamps. And I don't know, I don't know the exact proper level of food stamps. But another, you know, we have to do more on childcare. It's hard for people to go to jobs if there's not appropriate childcare. And so these are all places that I think the government, you know, has to be willing to make certain additional investments. And it's where I go back to the pension issue, that it's boring, but the magnitude maybe, but the magnitude of it is such. It just could be the whale that ate everything if we're not careful, and we'll have no money for any of these other priorities. And that's why I say, as this process goes on, it's important to pin down candidates as to, you know, exactly, you know, where they stand on these issues. So one of the exercises that I do is I say, okay, on average, state revenue has increased by about 3% a year, a little more, 3.45, I guess. And that equates to roughly $1 billion. Okay, how would you spend that billion? Some of it's going to go to inflation adjustments. I think some of it has to go to higher education. Some of it clearly has to go into making sure that we keep our promise on the pension issue. But some of it has to go toward the broader income inequality issues that we face. And so I don't know the specific answer on food stamps and what that level ought to be, but and I think the federal government, frankly, has a more important role to play than the state government. But and New Jersey is, as we all know, a state with, I guess, the highest immigrant population, certainly one of them. And so I believe that it's an area that the federal government has a responsibility to, but it's something that, again, has to be a high priority of the state. And if we go down some of these other roads that I talked about, we're not going to have the progress we need in that area. So, look, I saw a whole bunch more hands. I'm glad to see everybody still awake. Again, I appreciate your interest in all this, and I'm happy to hang around. So, if there are individual questions, I'm willing to stay here till Ryder kicks me out. So, thank you all.
He will be around. Ladies and gentlemen, especially the students, I want to remind you that tomorrow is the last day to register to vote in this November election. Please take advantage of the 24 hours that you've got to get that done. It is critical for any number of reasons, not the least of which you might be able to vote for this guy. So I want to thank everyone for coming out. I want to thank Tom Byrne again. Please note our next event, public event, will be December 1st. With Steve Kornacki from MSNBC, who will be here to talk about what the heck just happened in the election. Ladies and gentlemen, have a safe trip home. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.